Hello and welcome to episode 4 of A DM's Guide to the Tomb of the Nine Gods. Let's begin. So we're going to look at Obalaka's tomb. Obalaka's tomb is this area right here. We discussed it in the previous episode. So you gain access to this tomb via Area 6. So as your characters look through number 6, they see this. This vaulted tomb is overgrown with moss and creepers. A stone sarcophagus rests on a stepped dais in the middle of the floor. On the walls behind the sarcophagus, two large statues of bears grip a 5-foot diameter bronze disc embossed with a dozen glaring eyes. Desiccated corpses slump on the thrones in niches along the walls. Each corpse wears a black mask made of paper mache and feathers. Very interesting. Characters look inside, they can see there is 6 corpses. So 1 here, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Each of these are wearing a mask. Over here, they can see a bronze disc that is covered in bronze eyes. One thing you'd realise is in this tomb, everything is pitch black unless stated otherwise. And we know this room is about 25 feet across and also is about 12 feet high. We also have a secret door to the north and a secret door to the south. So let's talk about this disc then. So if your characters look through the window and look at this disc, what do they see? Any character that studies this disc notices the eyes are moving back and forth. These eyes have dark vision, which means they can see 30 feet. And if these eyes see in the player characters, they awaken these corpses here and they'll be attacked. These corpses are of the right, exact same stat block as the Tomb Dwarves we mentioned previously. So with these eyes on this disc, if any of the characters are wearing a Faberge mask from one of these corpses, the eyes cannot see them. So that's one way of getting past the puzzle. Also, you could destroy the two statues that are holding on to the disc right here. It has 45 hit points, AC of 17, and it's immune to bludgeoning, piercing, and slashing damage from non-magical attacks. Just so you know, if your characters are wearing one of these masks, they'll be able to open the sarcophagus with a strength check. Otherwise, they'd have to cast a knock spell, or they'd have to do a dexterity check with thieves' tools. So let's play this scenario out then. Your characters have to get into this room somehow. So they'll get into this room via number 6. So number 6 is a window that sees into the tomb. We know that the window peers into the tomb, it cannot be opened, and it blocks all sound between area 6 and 10, which means that they can't really cast spells in if they've got a verbal component. If your character does 15 points of damage in one strike, they'll break open this window right here. We're then going to make the assumption that the eyes can see into here. If your characters go in, they'll be seen by the eyes and they'll be attacked by the corpses or the rites. So how do your characters prevent this? Well, they could cast magical darkness. They could wear masks by doing mage hand from the corpses there. So one of my characters looked for the clues and they read on the mask or be seen. So what they did was they used the leaves outside the tomb and they made makeshift masks for the entirety of the party. Because of that, I thought that was very out of the box thinking and I allowed my characters to go through and not be seen by these eyes with that method because I believe that was very interesting. However, they did have to take the mask from the corpse to open the sarcophagus with the strength check. What happens if your characters trigger the trap? So let's say you have one character who comes in. How would you play the rites? Well, in my experience, I would play the rites as intelligent because they're trapped in this tomb and they've been programmed to defend it. My personal opinion, what I would do is the rites are going to get a surprise round and they're not going to follow your characters out of the tomb. So what are they going to do? Well, first thing I'll do is I'll get these two rites here, 1 and 2. They're going to move and they're going to, first thing is going to block the flank. And this is going to stop the players from getting out in the easiest way possible. They've also got a multi-attack, which means that they can use one of their attacks to life drain, which is really important. So they'll attack player of life drain, and then potentially they could help. That's what these will do then. And then the rest will come out and they'll surround the character. That's if there's one person. If it's a party, what they'll do is they'll try their best to block the route so the party can't leave. And since they're here as the trap, I wouldn't say they have a consciousness, so they'll fight until death. So what happens when your characters go to the sarcophagus, they open it and they don't set off the trap? Well, they look inside and they'll find the first lot of treasure. So they'll find the bones of a Zorbo lying in a dusty pile within the sarcophagus. A ring of protection rests atop the pile. This ring is the ring of protection and inside hosts Obalaka's spirit. And if your characters touch the ring, as you touch the ring, the dust swirls into the shape of a small feral bear-like creature that bellows towards you with a ghostly roar. This spirit is now going to try to inhabit your character. So what does this mean? Who is Obalaka and what is the Trickster spirit? So Aserak trapped the spirits of almost 9 trickster gods in the tomb he constructed in their name, and they're not happy about it. The spirits are bound within magic items scattered throughout the tomb. A creature of the humanoid type touches such an item the trickster god bound within attempts to inhabit the creature. With a successful DC 16 charisma check, creature resists the god's power. On a failed save, or they choose to forego the save, they get inhabited. While inhabiting a host's body, the trickster god acts like an overbearing passenger. The host creature remains in control of his actions but inherits a flaw from the god as well as a special power. So let's look at Obalaka. So what is Obalaka? So Obalaka is lawful neutral. She's obsessive and nervous. Her flaw is, I am risk adverse and I am a slave to routine. And her enemy's Engine. She does not get on with Engine. Obalaka's special ability is, the host can attune to one additional magic item. However, when Obalaka leaves the host, all magic items attuned to the host is lost. So for my personal opinion, I believe Obalaka's power is the worst out of the 9 trickster gods. Just so you know. What happens then if your character is possessed by a trickster god and another trickster god, let's say Moa or Wongo, tries to inhabit as well? So what's going to happen is they're going to fight over who has the host. So when the two gods inhabit one character, they'll battle for the right to remain within the host. And it's really straightforward. You roll a dice. One god's odd, one god's even. And whoever's victorious, stays within. So one of the things I did was I really didn't want to roleplay the trickster gods in my campaign. So what I did was I told my players, hey, this is what the trickster god is. Try to roleplay them as best for ability. So what happened was my characters roleplayed their characters and also the trickster gods as well. And they did monologues explaining what the spirits were saying in their heads. That worked out for me because it made it a little bit easier for me to DM. And I thought it kind of allowed my players to actually get more involved in the tomb and the dynamics of the trickster gods. However, it's up to you, as in it says in the book that the DM can roleplay the voices of the characters' heads. But that is completely up to you. And the main thing with the trickster gods is they're all eager to get revenge on Aserak, but they can only offer limited guidance throughout the tomb. So they don't know the layout, they don't know anything like that. So the trickster gods give a massive buff to your player characters. So when you do the final fight with Aserak, each character will gain 50 temporary hit points at the start of every turn. And if a character makes an attack roll against Aserak and hits, they do extra psychic damage. As well as additional power they gain, it's very, very important. So one trickster god inhabits your character. They'll suggest to the player character to tell the rest of the party that getting trickster gods is good and they'll help defeat Aserak. The treasure of this tomb is that they gain a ring of protection as well as Obalaka. So the ring of protection has the stats of like so. So ring of protection, you gain +1 bonus to AC and saving throws while wearing this ring. So it's up to your choice when your characters finish the campaign. If you believe they've done a fantastic role at role-playing the trickster god's flaws, they can keep this item. However, if they've not been role-playing at all, this item will be destroyed when it leaves the tomb. So don't worry about your characters getting far too many magical items in the tomb and losing balance when they leave. As in, potentially, your characters will pick up a couple of items, but they shouldn't have the 9 different items from all the trickster gods. So if your characters explore this tomb and they come to the south, they'll notice the secret door if they've got a high enough perception. And this will take you to number 11. So number 11, if you open this secret door, you ignite the odorless gas, that is in area 11. As you pull the door, there's flint at the bottom and it will cause a massive detonation. The detonation will explode and this gas will deal 4d10 fire damage, or you make a dexterity saving throw, so you take half damage. And after 8 hours, this will build up again. If you continue south, you get to area 12. Water pours from cracks and seams in the rough walls of this tavern. Those floors is a muddy pool that flushes out into the tunnel beyond. Just above the pool surface, a large treasure chest dangles from rusty chains embedded into the ceiling. You can see the source of the river pouring in from here. So what's so important about this chest? Well, the chest is 6 foot long, 3 foot wide, and 3 foot high, and it's suspended. And it's above the water, which is 5 foot deep. So this is a trap to get that one member of your party who is just, maybe the rogue, who just wants to have everything. So your rogue's going to go in there, he's going to open the chest. When he attempts to open the chest, he'll notice that the keyhole is shaped like a crackling demon skull. He'll see a small inscription that says, I devour all but the greatest thieves. So either your character accepts the challenge or flees, it's up to them, but if they accept the challenge and they try to open it with their thieves' tools, they pick the lock and have to make a successful DC 22 dexterity save using their thieves' tools. This will disarm the lock's magical trap and allow you to take what's in it safely. So what's inside the chest? So it contains 300 gold pieces, a gold tankard with a sad face that smells when it's full of beard. It has a gold tankard embossed with a sad face that smells when the tankard is filled, which I think is a nice touch. And then you've got a spell scroll with removed curse. Interesting is, what happens if your character fails to do it? So if they fail the DC by 5, the magical trap's going to teleport them inside the chest and they're going to be dropped into the water. The chest has 30 hit points and has an AC of 13. And the main thing is that if your characters save the unlucky combatant who's inside and lift them out of the water, they'll still drown once they're out. They need to release them from the chest for them to breathe. So that's number 12. So now I'm going to talk about number 13, entrance to Moa's tomb. Number 13, stone skull. A giant stone skull crusted with moss juts out from the end of the passageway. A flame flickers within each of its eye sockets, and a view into a chamber yawned can be seen through its open jaws. So the stone skull open wide, which means that a medium or small creature can crawl directly through. However, whenever a creature crawls through, one of its eyes flickers out. So the first attempt to go through, nothing happens. Second attempt, nothing happens. On the third attempt, the jaws are going to bite shut. When the jaws bite shut, they'll do 4d10 bludgeoning damage, and then you'll be grappled. And when it clamps shut, it'll do a melee attack with a plus 10 to hit. Why is this important? Well, this works in two ways. Either you have a party of four players, so first person's fine, second person's fine, and it'll trap the third person. Or you have one person goes in, they trigger the trap in here, or for instance, they're fleeing for what reason, and they'll get trapped, and then whatever happens in this room will attack them as well, which I'll explain in more detail. So what happens when your players look through 13? What do they see in 14? 14, Moa's tomb. Skulls crusted with the dried mud glower from niches cut into the walls of this tomb. A stone sarcophagus stands in the centre of this chamber. Its lid adorned with a coiled serpent carved in the relief. Behind the sarcophagus, resting atop a marble pedestal, is an ornate crystal box with a small humanoid skull floating inside it. So what is this small humanoid skull? Well, the small humanoid skull trapped in the box is the granddaughter of the former queen of Omu, and she's 10 years old. So Aserak has kidnapped this young girl, she's been killed, and her skull has been trapped in this crystal box. As soon as your characters enter this room, the voice of the young girl echoes in your mind. What's happening? Why can't I see? Nippertak, I do apologise if announcing the name wrong. You have a young child's head that's trapped in here, and she's got the statistics of a flame skull. As soon as your characters come in, this young girl is going to talk to them. So she can't see and she can't hear. She's a scared young girl in the pitch black that's been isolated for hundreds of years. Due to the crushing isolation, she can't remember anything. So she's going to start asking questions. Where am I? How did I get here? Why can't I see anything? Are you friends of my father? Is he looking for me? On obelisk number one, you got a clue regards to this room. Speak no truth to the doomed child. If you tell her what's happened to her, she's going to explode into a tantrum and she's going to attack everyone. The voice screams in horror as the skull's eye sockets flare with green flame. With a shattering crash, crystal box explodes and the skull levitates in the air. The main thing is, you need to roleplay this flame skull as a child. As in, she's trapped, she's scared, she's not going to think well. So, what can a flame skull do? They can cast spells. With my personal preference, I'd fire Fireball right away. She's going to be so angry she's going to fire off all the main spells at once. She's not going to think well, as in she's not been trained for combat. She's simply a girl that's been trapped and her skull's been preserved. So she'll be panicking and attacking. What else happens when she panics? Well, the room is surrounded by little niches and within are swarms of undead spiders. And I honestly think this is one of most terrifying ideas of this room triggers and spiders crawl from out the walls. If I was a character, I would run away. And if I ran away in this situation, I could be trapped by number 13. So you can prevent 13 from closing. So what you will do is you jam it with something. So you can jam a bit of wood, you can jam a bit of metal, whatever, as long as it can take that damage there. 22 bludgeoning damage. And also your characters can perceive and see the mechanism if they do a perception check as well. What happened when my characters came in here? They walked into the tomb, and the first thing was my bard said out loud, "Hey, why are you a skull in a box?" That instantly triggered the doomed character, and she started to fire a fireball. With the swarms of spiders, I thought it could be a very, very scary encounter, so I prepared. However, my cleric cast Turn Undead, and that killed all six of these in one go. That's one thing to watch out for. Clerics will destroy this room and kill the undead. So that was my experience. So the way I would run this is that the child remains nice as long as you deceive her. So you lie to her. So she asks, like, where am I? You could answer, I'm not too sure. And as long as you keep on doing deception checks, she's fine, nothing's going to happen. Also, this tomb in the center of the room, you can simply lift up the strength check, and inside you'll find the treasure, which is Trixagon Moa and the Staff of the Python. So, Moa the Jackal, the truthful and kind. Flaw, when inhabited by Moa, you gain the following flaw, which overrides any opposing flaw. I must always speak the truth. So, if your character gets possessed by Moa in this room, they'll have to speak the truth to the child in self-trap. However, Moa's got a really cool power. While enhanced by Moa, you can use an action to turn invisible, which is perfect. Let's say you've got a rogue, turn invisible, they can always get their sneak attacks, they've got advantage. And then you'll gain the Staff of the Python. Staff of the Python, you can use an action to speak the staff's command word and throw the staff on the ground within 10 feet of you. The staff becomes a giant constrictor snake under your command. Pretty cool. And with this, if your snake gets attacked, if it goes to 0 hit points, it's permanently destroyed. However, if you revert it back into the staff, it will regain all its hit points. We're now looking at Area 15 and 16, which is Wongo's tomb. Area 15 here is very straightforward. It's a long hallway, and it has a big fan, or you can call it big spinning blades, in front of you. Area 15, known as the Wind Tunnel. Carved birds soar across the walls of this corridor. Blocking the passage near its northern end is a large adamantine propeller with 5 sharp blades. If your characters perceive the floor, and they do a successful check, they realize the whole floor is a pressure plate. If they step on the floor, this blade here begins to spin. It takes a whole 6 seconds, so one turn, for it to spin to full speed. And if your characters are within 10 feet, your character will fly through and get chopped by the blades. The blades can be damaged, and if your character decides he wants to stop it, he can damage each individual blade. Or if they're really foolhardy and strong, they can hold it while it's stationary. And if they stop the blade 3 times, it'll cease to function and the tomb dwarves will come and fix it. This is really important because this trap affects how Wongo's tomb works, as I'll explain in a moment. So you have, in here, this is Wongo's tomb. A deep pit opens up at the entrance of this tomb, with a stone sarcophagus resting at the bottom. A snarling monkey-like creature decorates the sarcophagus lid. Beyond the pit, three treasure chests sit on stone daises. The chest on the left is carved of black onyx, the middle chest is made of rusty iron, and the chest on the right is cast of silver and glistening with frost. So we have 3 chests. And we have the sarcophagus here. What I've done is I have drawn this just so it makes a bit more sense. So this is side view. So your characters come in here. If they walk, if they step in this pressure blade, this will spin up. It will cut them up and it will throw them into this pit. So this pit is 20 feet deep, and because we know Serac is really intelligent, I'm going to make the assumption that these walls are slick, so you can't climb these walls. So you can either chuck a rope down from this side here, because if you stand this pressure plate here, this will spin and push you back into this hole. We have 3 chests. The chests are 6 foot long, 3 foot tall, and 3 foot wide, so a player character can fit inside. If your character opens any of these chests, it reveals a 3-inch long gold key protruding from the adamantium keyhole. This key here cannot be removed unless you close the chest. Once you close the chest, it will make a noise indicate to your players. So what happens when you turn the key? So your players turn the key, depending on which of the chests you choose, a button will appear on the sarcophagus. Once all 3 keys are spun, all 3 buttons will appear. Your characters click all those buttons, you can then access the sarcophagus. And that's when the next part of this trap begins. What happens when your characters press these buttons? Well, let's say your character goes inside. He then locks it. He's locked inside this chest. And if any of your party members press the button, interesting things will happen. So let's say that he's inside the onyx chest. If your player's inside the chest, you hit the button, they'll have to make a DC 15 constitution saving throw, or take 10d6 plus 4e force damage. So it's a massive point of damage. And if they reduce to 0 hit points, they turn to pile of dust and they are dead. If they're within the middle chest made of rusty iron and you press the button, it causes any non-magical vital objects inside to turn to rust. If you're within the silver box, you hit the button. If you press the button, it'll do cold damage of 10d8 cold damage. So that's a typical solution. You go inside, lock yourself in, and then you get hit by a lot of damage and potentially kill your players. The way my characters did it was very straightforward. They closed the chest, and then they cast Mage Hand inside, and they opened it that way. Or also, you can use a spell such as Find Familiar. You can summon Familiar, they'll be inside, you close the chest, and they can open it that way without doing damage. Many different ways of doing it. Let's now talk about Sophocus. Your characters have now successfully opened the Sophocus. What happens? So they pressed all three buttons. The stone Sophocus turns to a transparent crystal, revealing a mummified monkey-like creature within. Clutched on its desecrated claws is a fearsome mace. We've now opened the Sophocus, so you now have your characters going to be attacked by a mummy in the shape of a monkey and is holding a mace. So in the previous tombs, you got the item. This time, you're being attacked by the item. What is this mace? So this is Wongo's Mace of Terror. So it has three charges. While holding it, you can use an action to expend one charge to release a wave of terror. Each creature of your choice within 30-foot radius must succeed in a wisdom saving throw. If they fail this, they're frightened of you, and while they're frightened, they must spend their turns to move as far away as you can. They can take reactions, and they have to dash. First thing the mummy's going to do is he's going to attack. So he's going to hit you with the mace. So he's going to trigger this ability, Wave of Terror. You're going to flee, and you're probably going to run this way and trigger the blade. The blade will spin, and it will bring you back into the tomb again. And this could repeat over and over again. However, if you're not scared and you get hit by the mace, you're going to be possessed by Wongo. Red smoke seethes from the head of the mace, forming the outline of a monkey with a long tail. With a roar, the smoky apparition leaps at you, screaming, "Let me in." This is your first spirit. That's evil. So have you got any of the other spirits so far? You have Moa, who's good. Now you've got Wongo, who's evil. So he might make your party do bad, bad things. So if your character gets inhabited by Wongo, what happens? What's his flaw and what's his special power? So Wongo is a Sioux monster and he's violent and deranged. While inhabited by Wongo, you gain the following flaw, which overrides any opposing flaw. I act without concern of the well-being of others. If your character gets inhabited by this, he's probably going to be harming the other players, which, depending on how your party goes, might get him killed. But make it a very interesting game. I think Wongo's power is actually probably one of the better ones. So while inhabited by Wongo, you can use your action to release a psychonic assault on a creature you can see within 60 feet of you. Target must succeed on a DC 16 wisdom saving throw or be stunned until the next turn. The reason why this power is really strong is your character can do this every single turn. So they can come in, you've got a big bad guy, he can stun them, your whole party can attack it, and he can just repeat that over and over again. Unlimited uses is very, very good. However, he is evil, so he might cause some party disturbances there. Your player character has been attacked by this mummy. As soon as it lands a hit and he's possessed by Wongo, what happens next is the mummy is now friendly towards that character and no one else. So let's say you have four players in here. Only one of them is friendly, so this mummy's going to attack the other people. So what can the mummy do then? Well, it won't have the mace anymore. It has a very, very low armor class. Its hit points aren't too high. It's vulnerable to fire, but it has its Rotten Fist ability, which is very, very dangerous because in the Tomb of the Nine Gods and with this campaign, if you lose hit points, you cannot bring them back. So you get hit with this Rotten Fist ability. Characters have to make a DC 12 Constitution saving throw or be cursed by the mummy rot. A cursed target can't regain hit points, and its hit points maximum decreases by 10 every 24 hours. So while this curse happens, your characters will lose 3d6 hit points, which will keep on happening. So hopefully you have a cleric in your party, otherwise this could kill your characters with one hit. And also with mummies, you can't charm a mummy, you can make them exhausted, and you can make them frightened, paralyzed as well. Easy to kill, but they have some horrible effects. So to conclude this, your characters come in, they have to unlock three chests, hit the three buttons on Sophocus. This then triggers the mummy to come out. They then get possessed by Wongo, and then they're free to go. And to destroy this blade, it has five blades and each has different hit points. So the adamantium propeller each has an AC of 20 and 30 hit points. If you jam anything inside it, it will be destroyed unless it's an immovable rod. And if you slash through it at full speed, you'll take 12d10 slashing damage. And if you try to block it or jump through and it's spinning slowly, you can take 6d10 damage. So it's a lot of damage. And yeah, so that is area 15-16. So that is the last Trickster God in this level, Wongo's Tomb. So that's us finished level 1 Rotting Halls. On the next episode, we're going to descend down to level 2. Thank you very much for watching. Like and subscribe, and I'll see you next time. Ciao.